2 already in progress.
3 drifts that had marks or patterns that I could line up, that I could keep in focus. And I would reach the first one, and then I would sight beyond the last one. So I was always moving toward one of those drifts in the same direction. Well, as I walked along further and further, the snow continued to get more and more heavy. The wind picked up. It was blowing and swirling. And finally, I couldn't sight beyond what I could see right in front of me. So at that point in time, I knew I was in trouble. Got to a point where I couldn't discern the difference between the falling snow and the ground, and it was a very weird feeling. It was like when I stepped, I couldn't tell that I was stepping on the packed snow. I couldn't see anything. It was totally disoriented. When I looked out, all I saw was falling snow. When I hit an uneven surface in one of the drifts, I fell. I was disoriented. I was dizzy. I couldn't tell if I was vertical. And without taking more than a couple of steps, I fell again. I began this pattern of standing, stepping, falling, fall one side, fall to the other side. I had no sense of my direction. It wasn't just being disoriented or lost. It was, if something doesn't happen to change this, if the storm doesn't clear or something doesn't happen, I'm dead. I'm gonna just crawl on this ice until I'm dead. I guess I recognized at that point how frail life is, how really marginal the fact that we live at all is. And at that point, I totally gave in. I said, hey, look, God, if you're out there, if you have any intention of me surviving this, then you're gonna have to do something because I can't. At that point, I heard a very deep horn, like a foghorn. I had no idea where it came from. And I said, if that was a sign, you're gonna have to make this loud and clear, because otherwise I'm not gonna get it. I need to know where it came from. And again, I heard this sound, and I locked onto it and remember moving off into the direction it came from. As I began crawling across the ice, I heard sound kind of like in the back of my head, like when someone sneaks up right behind you and whispers and it startles you and the hair stands up on your neck and you jump. I heard this voice say, watch out for the breakwater. And I realized the breakwater would have possibly kept the ice from freezing up, and that if I fell into that water, I would probably drown.
Let himself be guided by the mysterious voice, skirting the lethal breakwater and struggling to the bank where he collapsed in a snowdrift.
There was a person who reached out and put his arms around me. He gripped me under the arms in a bear hug, like, get in here, get out of the cold, you dummy, you know, just reached out and felt myself being pulled into the building. Not everyone gets to a point in their lives where they realize that if they maintain absolute control over their lives are going to end immediately. I had to completely give up control of my life, because I knew at that point that if I was the one who was in control, I would have been dead, and that there would have been nothing else. I mean, it was cut and dry.
Bill remembers little from the rest of that night. Only that the man revived him and somehow he found his way home. As the next day dawned, bright and clear, Bill returned to the cabin to thank his rescuer.
The station was closed up. There was a sign on the door that said, closed for the season. I realized that something pretty unusual, unexplainable, miraculous had happened.
There was no sign that anyone had been in the cabin for months.
I believe that I was saved by an angel. If I hadn't believed that guardian angels were real, I wouldn't have asked for help. And if I hadn't asked for help, even if it came, I'm not sure I would have recognized it. You have to come to realize that there's a greater power working in the universe than the one that's just ticking inside your mortal body. And that essentially everyone is part of that greater connection.
And the angel said to the man, "There was only one set of footprints because I was carrying you in my arms." In a complicated and sometimes dangerous world, it is reassuring to consider that we are never so lost that our angels cannot find us.
Angels 2, Beyond the Light, will continue in a moment.
These days, anyone can design and build a car with the quality and features you want and the safety you need. That's easy. We designed and built the all-new 1995 Lumina, so most people can afford it. And that's what makes the new Lumina a genuine Chevrolet.
You're looking at an amazing cleanser so powerful, it's actually penetrating this tough stain right before your eyes. This is Soft Scrub Cleanser, the only liquid with scrubbers plus Clorox bleach. Soft Scrub cleans the toughest stains faster and easier than even the leading scouring powder. Soft Scrub with Clorox bleach, the amazing liquid that outcleans the powder.
When a delectable Eggo waffle is at stake, there are generally two types of competitors. Type A personalities are tense, plotting how they'll grab the Eggo, pour syrup into each and every square, and devour it. Type B is relaxed, imagining how they'll savor one scrumptious bite after another. Which type is more likely to win that hot, toasty Eggo? Statistically, studies show it's Type C, the speedy, hungry kid type. Delicious Eggo waffles, too delicious to let go.
You're about to enter a new era in television. With this 18-inch RCA satellite dish, you get CD quality sound, 150 channels, and a digital picture so sharp, so real, it raises home theater to a new level. The RCA Digital Satellite System. Television will never be the same.
It's Saturday, and the Millers are baking Nestle Toll House
First
cookies.
Turn on the oven.
Yes, we turn on the oven.
Daddy, do you even know how to bake Nestle Toll House cookies?
I know to use Nestle Toll House morsels. They're so rich and creamy.
Real rich and creamy.
Bake with rich, creamy morsels to get the world's best-tasting cookie.
From now on, I'm going to call you rich and you creamy. Now, who wants to help me clean up?
I think creamy does.
Rich, creamy Nestle Toll House morsels. This weekend, make your house a Toll House.
A jealous husband.
I do anything not to lose her.
Mine's the perfect crime.
He's gonna kill the boyfriend.
Unless Cosby stops him in time. All new Cosby Mysteries, NBC Wednesday.
Jacqueline Kennedy Onassis.
A public figure, but a private woman. A new book shares photographs from her family album. Join Bryant and Katie Monday and see what a difference today makes.
Angels 2, Beyond the Light, will return in a moment.
NBC Tuesday on All New Wings.
They just want to be alone. Then a special Tuesday episode of Friends. And why is an all-new Frasier the most hated man in town?
We're still on the air.
Then John loves her, but can he resist another woman's seduction? All-new Laura Kent, NBC Tuesday.
Let's keep the record straight. Government employees will not be fired in order to balance a budget. Not under my administration. We wouldn't need to. We wouldn't want to. The budget will be balanced through attrition, early retirement, and by cutting waste. It doesn't make sense to fire government employees. It would increase unemployment and further devastate the economy. My desperate opponents make desperate charges. But you know where I stand. Give me a chance. I'll get the job done.
And I want you to know that we're going to go from Wallagut to Freegut. We're going to go from Christiansted to Fragstead. We're going to go from Grove Place to Bordeaux. And we're going to go from Shaw Lamley to Cruz Bay. And when all is said and done, on November the 8th, 1994, we're going to win. And we're going to have a majority in the legislature. We're going to have a Democratic candidate in Congress. And we're going to have a governor and lieutenant governor who are Democrats in government house.
Derek Hodge and Alfred Heath, your team.
Atlanta's attraction to Angels, tonight at 11.
Some people believe that angels appear more often to children because they are more open and more imaginative than adults. But perhaps angels come more often to children because they are the most vulnerable and the most in need of protection.
I came from an abusive home. The abuse was physical. That predominantly on the part of my father. And the abuse occurred over an extended period of time. Many beatings. When I was a little past my ninth birthday, I had been told by my father to clean a rug that was in the basement. Boy, I can picture it. It's so vivid in my memory right now. The rug hanging over a wire in our basement, and there were steel pylons in the basement also. No ceiling to the basement at all. My dad came home that afternoon and went down and put this big handled tennis racket like thing that I was supposed to beat on this rug and get all this dirt out of it with. And my dad, of course, took a whack at it, and being much larger, much stronger, he got dust out of it that Bob Plummer, the child, was unable to. And so he went to his belt strap one more time after having tied me to one of the bars. While he was tying me to the bar, and I can remember how I said it, "Please don't let this happen anymore." And this angel appeared. To me as a child, boy, this was an angel. Beautiful, powerful, just an enormous figure standing there. And I said to him, "Make this be the last time." The belt never hit me. This time, the belt never hit me. He dropped the belt. He started crying, and he ran upstairs.
After this experience, it didn't take long for Bob's guardian angel to once again offer help. The angel's guidance allowed Bob to use his love of music to escape from the abuse.
The next day, when I went to school, my music teacher, and I can still remember her name, Mrs. Hebling, she called me into her office, and she said, "Bob, I've arranged an audition for you." And the angel was behind her. I could see him again, and he's standing there, he's just smiling away, but still as big and still as powerful as ever. She says, "Well, if you make it, you won't be going to school here anymore." And they travel all over the world. Boy, somebody has heard me. Well, I went to the audition. I was selected. I spent the next 5 years in the Columbus Boy Choir School. And I was very seldom home. It took me a long time to find out who he was. I didn't know then. I just know I had asked, and the angel had appeared. He said nothing at all. And yet, His silence spoke magnitudes. His power filled that basement, and it filled it with just a glorious silence. After that late afternoon in the basement of the house, after the abuse was stopped for that time, my father never touched me again.
When we speak of angels, we most often think of love, compassion, and patience. Not every lesson can be taught softly. There are times when we must face great pain and loss, because that is when our greatest learning occurs.
I was a cop for about 5 years, and the last several years I was on a tactical unit and involved a lot of plainclothes work, some undercover work, and in 1975 our unit was involved in a couple of shootouts in which people were killed. One shootout in particular happened on Good Friday in 1975, and it involved a guy going berserk, and he shot two police officers, actually three police officers, as they arrived on the scene. There was nothing we could do to get them out of there, because every time an attempt was made, the sniper would start shooting, and by the time it was all over, two of them were dead and one was a quadriplegic. So I believe that's the day that I totally lost faith and I turned towards a bottle. Got to the point where I became a daily drunk and I could no longer function on my job and had to leave. And then a period of years, I lost everything I had. You know, I lost my home, my wife, family, everything. I lost literally everything I had because of my drinking.
Alan's life continued to spiral downward until he found himself alone and desperately ill with no one to turn to.
I was just in and out of this fever, and I was convinced I was going to die. And I remember thinking that my only regret was that I wouldn't get to see my son anymore. I wanted to see my son one more time. When I really thought I was going to go, I heard this voice say, "Fear not, for I am always with you." And at that point, it felt like a warm liquid rushed through my entire body, and my whole body became totally relaxed, and the fever broke. There was some spirit, whatever it was, that intervened at that point to help me, you know, and that could have been an angel. I don't know what it was. It sounded like a male voice, but I felt a presence, and the fever broke exactly at that point.
Alan slowly began to piece his life back together and even to see a reason, perhaps, for his suffering.
I realized that if I hadn't been through the hell I'd been through, that there's no way I would be where I'm at today. You know, my pain caused me to look within myself, and in that way it was a great teacher, and it's what helped transform me and to look inside me and to cleanse myself and try to become a better human being.
Alan's life work today centers around giving back some of the love that the angels once gave to him.
I've been involved with working with extremely emotionally disturbed kids, and for the last 3 or 4 years working with kids, mainly with a lot of family problems, a lot of social problems, sex abuse, physical abuse, neglect, alcohol and drug abuse. My whole job, in effect, is trying to protect these kids and to advocate for them and try to empower them. They've been hurt all their lives, and that's why our job is so important, to try to help them and love them back to health. You know, it doesn't have to stay crazy out there. It can improve. I couldn't force anyone to believe it, but through my experiences, you know, there's no doubt in my mind that something exists outside of me that helps people. And I believe these are angels.
It is said that at the moment of our birth, we are each assigned a guardian angel whose instructions are, love this child and watch over it. They are essential instructions intended not only for angels, but for people as well.
Coming up next. next, George Harrison, Evander Holyfield, and Carlos Santana.
How fast can you begin to feel relief from a cold? Depends. How fast can you open the halls with vapor action? Halls vapor action means instant action, only from the halls of medicine.
Chew on this. Down in Austin, the hottest places to eat ribs are the hardest places to brush your teeth. Now chew on this. Chewing Trident with NutraSweet after meals can actually help you fight cavities. So when you can't brush, chew on this. Trident.
I was shocked to learn that most ordinary credit cards charge interest from the moment you buy something, if you carry a balance as little as a dollar. Thankfully, American Express has introduced a new credit card called the Optima True Grace Card. You get an interest-free grace period on each new purchase, even when you carry a balance. It's a good thing.
But don't just throw away your old credit cards. Recycle them. I'm retiling my pool.
Apply today and cut your interest charges.
Look, Mom, I made my own breakfast.
Life is a compromise. Fortunately, it's also a cereal.
Orange juice, orange soda, what's the difference?
Life is the wholesome whole grain Quaker Oat cereal that strives to satisfy your parental caretaking needs.
A jelly donut, please, but no milk.
And life is the delicious roasted, toasted, lightly sweet, crispy, crunchy cereal your kids will actually eat.
Look, Mom, and have life sale for breakfast. And smudge.
Life is a compromise. Fortunately, it's also a cereal.
Glass and surface cleaners are okay for lots of surfaces, but when it comes to cleaning glass, Windex is the best. Because only Windex is specially formulated with ammonia D to clean the best and shine the brightest for a difference just about anyone can appreciate. Windex, the best on glass from S.C. Johnson Wax. Also available in fresh potpourri scent.
Hemorrhoids are a special problem for women. If you've ever had a baby, you know what I mean. But now there's a hemorrhoid medicine made just for women called Hemorrhoid. Aloe-enriched Hemorrhoid is extremely kind to a woman's delicate tissues. Yet it's wonderfully effective. Nothing else you can buy helps stop pain and itch fast and helps shrink swollen tissues and promotes the healing process. No wonder most doctors surveyed would recommend Hemorrhoid's special formula. New Hemorrhoid, with the formula made just for women and trusted by doctors.
The year 2192. The Earth is dying. The mission, go beyond the galaxy and find a new home.
We're on the other side of the stars.
A place for hopes. A place for dreams. A place...
Oh, Lord.
Where we are the aliens.
We didn't come this far to stop now.
It's not about friendship.
Mom?
It's about survival.
22 light years for this.
I haven't given up yet, and I know you haven't either.
This November, enter a world light years away, but closer than you think. Earth 2, the adventure begins next Sunday at 7, 6 Central on NBC.
Angel encounters are being reported in greater numbers than ever before, and these sightings represent an increasing interest in our spiritual nature. There are those among us who have studied spiritual matters for many years, and their explorations are helping to introduce the mystery and wonder of angels to all of us. Matthew Fox is a priest and author who writes about his own views on angels and inner spirituality.
Frankly, I don't believe they're angels. I know they're angels. You don't believe something that you've experienced.
The fact is that people experience angels, and people always have.
It's just understood that there's a spirit world. By all religions, angels, it seems to me, are not divided by Roman Catholic, Anglican, Lutheran, Baptist, Buddhist, or Native American, just as we don't have Anglican rivers and Lutheran sun and Buddhist oceans and Roman Catholic cornfields, so you don't have angels divided.
Why then are we as people so divided?
We're looking for something to fill our hearts with, our souls and hearts, and we've tried consumerism, it doesn't work.
You can only drive so many cars and have so many refrigerators and eat so much food. What are we hungry for that we're not getting? And it is an experience of the sacred. Well, Meister Eckhart says, the great 14th century Dominican mystic said, God is at home, it's we who've gone out for a walk. So that's good advice, return home, wake up. I love that phrase about get a life, but I change it slightly, get an inner life.
Diamata grew up as Faye Wright in Salt Lake City, but her path has led her to become the spiritual mentor of thousands, including Robin Williams and George Harrison.
No question about it. I do believe in angels, have always believed in angels. This world is tremendously infinite, and we do need those kinds of help from the beyond, so to speak. I've always felt that I've had a guardian angel. We have devoted 24 hours in the day to the pursuit of material things that have to do with this fleshly form. We feed it, we clothe it, we entertain it, we house it. Can each man in this world not give 15 to 20 minutes a day pulling his mind away from all of these things and give that 15 or 20 minutes to just thinking uplifting thoughts, thinking how can we do good in this world, doing something that was uplifting to mankind? That's what's needed.
Many of Diamata's students believe she is an angel on earth.
In 1966, after Beatlemania and all the success that we'd had, I was still felt like this isn't it, I need something else. And it occurred to me this age-old question about who am I, where have I come from, and where am I going? And so I pursued that, and it led me to India.
George Harrison's spiritual path eventually led him to Diamata.
There have been a lot of use of the word guru, and until it's been abused, actually. But guru means dispeller of darkness. And Diama, she is an angel in herself. She may not like to hear me say that, but the essence, what people think, what is the essence of an angel? It's somebody who's angelic, somebody who has that divinity within themselves. Just the presence within a person like Diamata is what I would call the angelic quality.
Many people are discovering angels. Evander Holyfield is the former world heavyweight boxing champion.
We all have angels, and it's our choice to use these angels or not. I truly believe that some people don't use the angel because they don't think they have an angel. Well, I know that I have an angel because of how my life has been, and I was brought up, and to know that my protection is my angel.
Evander discovered the power of spirituality early in life.
You know, growing up in a family of eight and being the youngest one, not having a father there, and the older I got, you know, I realized that, you know, I got to be an example, you know, what a man's supposed to be. You cannot actually really call yourself a man if you're really not spiritual. Being spiritual is to mean to be strong and not being soft. The spiritual is the strongest thing in this world.
Some people have always lived a creative existence, but experiencing angels can change the expressions and the purpose of that creativity. The legendary guitarist Carlos Santana has stirred people with his music for three decades, but his recognition of the presence and the power of angels began many years after his music became his life.
I feel very grateful because I've been doing this since 1955, you know, because my first words in English were like, "Son, Mister, 50 cents a song." Well, like most people, the first time I heard about angels is through my mom. But you know, we've been lied so much about Santa Claus and so many things that it was hard to like take that as something that you can lean on. It was like Peter Pan or something.
Although there are references to angels in Santana's music and even on his album covers early in his career, it wasn't until the 80s that he began to study angels in earnest. He soon discovered a new spiritual path for himself and his music.
I started becoming really aware of the angels firsthand around 88. And that's the first one that it made me realize that it wasn't something phony. The more I read about angels, the more I felt my music was changing. My goal now with music is not the same. It's not just to make people dance. Anybody can do that now. It's like saying anybody can think. We want people to be conscious. Being conscious is different than just thinking.
Today, it seems as if Santana is directly inspired by his connection with the angels.
You go to a place where you don't have to tell your fingers, this finger goes into this string, or this bar, or this volume, or this amplifier. You go to a place where all of a sudden, you hear a note that sounds like a flaming arrow. To me, it's like an arrow sound that I hear. Once I hear it, you hear it.
At the start of every concert, Santana invokes the presence of the angels.
We always say, it's a great joy to be here tonight in the concerts. And we feel very grateful to see you here. And before we start with the sound vibration, we encourage you to look with your heart and not with your mind, so that you will see that we are all completely and absolutely surrounded by angels. And we see them and we feel them dancing, forever dancing in the flesh. Angels to me have given me a different kind of energy, different kind of thought, different kind of goals. Food tastes different. My way of change, wearing clothes is different. I wear more bright colors, and I have discovered, you know, that my goal or my mission is to awaken people to their fullest potential. My tools is sound and color. I do feel like we are making connection with the angel kingdom. Angels are working really hard in our lives for us to wake up and discover other means to complement and enhance life in this planet.
One of the ways Carlos Santana makes that angelic connection and works to better life in the world is through his support of the Mission Cultural Center in San Francisco. Here, local artists are opening the creative floodgates for the children in their community.
Well, this is part of our outreach program to introduce children to the arts here at the center. And through the arts, we teach them their culture. What you see here is the Angelitos, which is kind of an inspiration. Many of the ancient cultures have little symbolic angels to protect the children, and that kind of symbolizes, you know, to them a sense of protection and someone guarding over them.
The children develop new talents that emerge as they create the angels they see in their imaginations.
Einstein said imagination is more important than knowledge. Okay, so the next time a teacher sees a kid imagining something, don't hit him with the eraser over the head. Find out what he's thinking about. Maybe he's thinking of a cure for cancer.
But there's more being created here than mere works of art. There are healing energies present that help the children endure the hardships many have experienced throughout their lives.
What did you think about when you were drawing that?
And I was trying it, I thought about my brother. Who I never got to know. Because he died. My uncle. And my sister who also died.
All of us carry a lot of pain. Healing means to be whole and sound. That's my job. I work with sound. So we heal people. I believe in my heart that angels today, what they long for the most is for us to have more compassion. When you do something for the highest good of all people, those are the fingerprints that angels leave behind.
Beyond the Light will continue in a moment.
Looking good. Facing with your car is a great idea.
Yeah, especially when it's my new Grand Am.
Well, he couldn't take my car. Doesn't have analog brakes or an airbag.
Or 150 horsepower. Your car couldn't keep up with me.
Man, this engine is really smooth.
What?
I said you're really starting to move.
Hey, where are you?
So I did some checking, and I found out $2.99 is really the same thing as $3, except it's a penny less. So some burger joint's got a meal cost $2.99. Big whoop. Who cares if it's only $2.99 if I'm not gonna like eating it? But if you make it taste good, you know, like a Whopper. Flame broiled, not fried. Maybe throw in some fries and a drink. I'll gladly pay you $2.99. Hey, I'd even go as high as 302.
Burger King. Get your burgers worth.
Let's see. Kmart's got low prices on things I use every day. I like that. Plus, great sales that make low prices even lower. Now, I like that. But is that enough for us, the demanding public? No!
We want something extra!
And Kmart has extras. They're new. Extra values, extra low prices, extra tiers, extras there. I like that. So I'm going back to Kmart for a few extra things, a few extra time.
There's hair, and there's hair with style. To get it, you need the right elements. Salon Selectives, a newly redesigned system of interlocking formulas. Elements you put together for the personalized level of cleaning, conditioning, and finish your hair needs. For style you build in, step by step, by step, to go beyond hair that's just there to hair with style. Salon Selectives, the elements of style.
ER, the show everybody's talking about, returns Thursday.
Let's move it, people. Let's not lose them.
Two sisters face a family crisis.
If you moved in with me, there'd be more than enough time.
A nurse must make a painful choice.
You probably shouldn't be doing that.
ER, back with an all-new episode, NBC Thursday.
Angels 2, Beyond the Light, will return in a moment.
It's big. It's bad. It's Roseanne and Tom, the movie.
They're gonna make me a superstar.
And it's a treat to critics everywhere.
I did it!
An amazing, electric, and fascinating tale. So powerful, People Magazine says, you'll want to sleep with a nightlight.
I'm not gonna go away.
Roseanne and Tom, the movie, NBC Monday.
There's a lot of talk in this campaign about which candidate you should trust. Maybe the question is, which of the candidates trusts you? Why aren't we told how much money this government has? Why won't they say who is on contract and how much they are paid? Where are the reports of the Star of Life, the missing cocaine, and the DeYoung Williams fiasco? What about a murdered policeman? Can you trust a candidate who doesn't trust you? Give us a chance. We open up government. We trust you to know the truth.
If you want your stomach to look like this, or you want the great feeling of a lean waistline, then you want 8-Minute Abs.
8-Minute Abs is great. I pop it in,
I'm done, and it works.
8-Minute Abs takes you through a series of simple movements scientifically designed into an 8-Minute program for fast results.
I use 8-Minute Abs, and I recommend it to all of my clients.
I used to wear loose clothes to hide my tummy, but look, now I use 8-Minute Abs.
The secret to 8-Minute Abs is using the abdominal muscles in a specific sequence to maximize effectiveness and give you results quickly and comfortably.
If you've got 8 minutes and a VCR, you'll get great abs too.
Call now to get yours for $19.95, and we'll also send 8-Minute Buns absolutely free.
For free 5-day express delivery, have a credit card or check ready and call 1-800-426-8600 or send check or money order for $23.95 to 8-Minute Abs. Post Office Box 193, Devon, Pennsylvania 19333 or call 1-800-426-8600.
The battle over Bibles in Cherokee County schools tonight.
The Golden Rule says, do unto others as you would have them do unto you. And while the helping hands of angels can reach out to anyone, perhaps their light shines brightest on those who freely give love and support. This is a story of one woman who was always there for others. When her time of danger came, the angels were there for her. Mrs. New Velvet Washington teaches learning disabled and emotionally disturbed children in Washington, D.C. She often invokes angels to help her students achieve their full potential.
Sometimes when I get a student that's older and they can't read, if I'm going to test them that morning to see if they have learned some of the words or just going to read to me on a one-to-one, I dispatch angels to help them.
A recent family crisis brought New Velvet into personal contact with the angels. When her sister-in-law fell gravely ill, paramedics were called for, but the ambulance had no room for New Velvet, and she drove to the hospital separately.
As I was driving, I started to pray because I knew that she was really sick. So I started praying to save her life, because she takes care of 3 grandchildren, and if something happened to her, I don't know what would happen to the children.
Full of concern for others, New Velvet was unaware that she faced mortal danger.
This car came from my left, and it was really speeding. I saw that the accident was gonna happen. I said, oh God, I saw my life flash before me. I just felt that once the impact took place, that was going to be it. That's when I felt the hands. I felt these hands touch me. And then the next thing I knew, I was above the accident scene, looking down. And the hands were still there. And I was just amazed at what I was looking at, because I was just actually looking at the accident. I just felt that if I was in that car, I would be dead. And I said, gee, I'm looking at my life. And then I wasn't sure I wasn't already dead, because I was up there looking down, so I was wondering if I was alive, because I could see my body still in there.
Officer Edward Roach was the first help to arrive.
I received the call and I responded to the scene immediately. As I drove up, the scene was total chaos. Cars were strewn all over. First thing that I thought of when I pulled up on the scene was how many fatalities there were, because I've never seen one this serious before. When I walked over to New Velvet's car, I presumed that she was either dead or seriously injured.
The other drivers were gravely injured, but New Velvet was protected by angelic hands.
I felt myself descending back down into the car, and the hands lifted off me. I started feeling myself to see if I was really there. And I couldn't see too well because I didn't have my glasses. And then I started feeling the car and it was there. And the windshield wasn't broken. And I kept looking around and I kept feeling for, I don't know, I always thought blood is always everywhere and I didn't see any. And that's when I realized that those hands had to be hands of angels.
This night forever changed New Velvet and her entire family. Her sister-in-law recovered, and the whole family gives thanks to the angels for averting multiple tragedy.
I believe it had not been for the angels, I know I wouldn't have had a sister today. I know I wouldn't have. But I thank God for angels. I thank God that I know about angels, that they exist.
New Velvet has always been a loving and caring person, but now there is something more.
There's the big change because there's a glow about her. You can just see it all the time. Even if she's not even smiling, she's glowing. And I just said, Velvet, you're so beautiful. You know, it's the inward beauty that's coming out now more so.
It was something else that God wanted me to do, and I hadn't done it yet. And that's why my life was spared. I just hope that I'm doing it each and every day. And I know that if I'm not, he will come to me and tell me through his angels.
The angels bring many gifts, rescue in moments of peril, inspiration for our lives, healings of the body and soul. But the greatest gift they bring, simply said, is love.
That tenderness, that feeling of being totally heard and accepted and loved and valued is so rare. And yet the angels are so free to give that to us without any demand. We don't, there's no requirement that you need to lose 10 pounds or cut your hair and then I'll love you. Angels simply don't work like that. There's a never-ending source of acceptance and love and tenderness. It blows me away.
In Sedona, Arizona, a spiritual haven for those searching for physical as well as emotional cures, Leah Stinnett, along with her husband Doug, practice the art of angelic healing. Long before Leah discovered she had angelic healing power, she had been in a stressful and unfulfilling career as a graphic designer. Then in 1986, she says the Archangel Michael, the chief of all angels, appeared before her.
Before my first angel encounter, I was not aware that there was even an energy in the unseen world, as we call it. I was sitting at the kitchen table. I was writing some messages and suddenly felt a different type of energy come in around me. My hand suddenly became very warm and energized. It's like someone has taken a grip around your wrist and is going to move your hand for you, but there's no physical person present. My hand wrote by itself, "I am Michael." It was a writing very different from mine, and I questioned, "Who are you? I don't know any Michael." My hand again became warm and tingly, and this time he wrote, "I am Archangel Michael." And he underlined it in a squiggly line that I'll never forget. And then he asked me to stand. He says, "I will show you who I am. Walk now down the hall to your bedroom and stand before your mirror." So a little bit reluctantly, I got out of the chair and walked down the hall to the bedroom. And as I'm looking in the mirror with my eyes fully opened, I saw this glowing blue light. It filled the entire space in front of me. And he said, "I am Michael." And together we will save the children.
Maria was overcome with emotion, yet puzzled by the angel's message. She didn't understand what he meant by, "We will save the children," until 2 years later, when the angels inspired her to begin a teaching series of classes called the Circle of Angels. During these classes, Leah feels the angels assist her in healing children going through traumatic experiences in their lives, both physical and emotional.
In the Circle of Angels, they learn to meditate. We help them to release fears, helping them study for tests, for instance, in school, or to be happy in an environment where they may be confronted with divorce. Children need something to grasp right now. They watch television, they see a lot of violence, they feel a lot of anger. School is empty to them. They have a feeling of hopelessness. The angels are messengers. They help the children realize that they are important.
Just having my kids here and teaching them this side about angels is really going to help them survive in society. And it's time. And these kids right here, this is the next generation. And it's going to change consciousness in a lot of ways.
In addition to using her angelic powers to inspire and heal children, Leah has also illustrated and written a series of books called The Little Angel Books that show children how they too can call upon the angels.
My greatest gift from the angels to humankind, to this planet, is the ability to help people recognize that we are all truly one people in one family of light.
Coming up, angels and the miracles they bring.
Extra sugar-free gum has extra long-lasting flavor, that you know. But extra reduces the risk of cavities, that you may not know. See, after you eat, pH levels in your mouth plummet. That's when plaque acids can cause tooth decay. Chewing neutralizes those nasty acids and brings pH levels back up, helping to keep your teeth stronger. The longer you chew, the better it works. So extra means long-lasting flavor and less risk of cavities.
Hello, America! Dale Gilbert here. Welcome to the 70th birthday bash for MGM and Kleenex tissues.
Oh, here they come!
Right now, when you buy any four boxes of Salt or Thicker Kleenex, plus one of these marvelous movies on video, you get $5 back. Choose from The Wizard of Oz, West Side Story, Moonstruck, and more. So hurry on in, because the MGM Kleenex Birthday Bash is now in stores everywhere.
If you want to lose weight, here's a great way. New Dexatrim Plus Vitamins. A way to help control your hunger all day so you can lose the weight, plus get the essential daily vitamins your body needs. Colette, you lost weight with Dexatrim.
I lost 11 pounds, and I feel great.
In clinical studies, people using Dexatrim lost twice as much weight as the people who didn't use Dexatrim. So start losing your weight today. New Dexatrim Plus Vitamins. Lose the weight, get the vitamins.
Dear Tylenol, thank you for inventing a medicine that doesn't taste like one.
Matthew no longer cries, screams, and hides when it's time to take it.
Nothing compares to your new bubblegum flavor.
Moms tell us relieving fevers has never been easier. Thanks to Children's Tylenol Bubblegum Suspension, its unique formula coats the medicine with a richer, thicker taste, so it's easier for kids to take, and it's easier on their parents, too. Children's Tylenol Suspension, the first choice of pediatricians.
Abortion and breast cancer, is there really a connection? This man swears there is.
You say scientists are trying to suppress evidence.
Who should you believe? Dateline Tuesday.
It's a devastating disease that strikes millions. It's called lupus. Now there's hope this killer can be stopped. A special Help Watch report. Get close, get answers on NBC Nightly News Monday.
Angels 2, Beyond the Light will return in a moment.
Monday, the Tonight Show will become a Halloween fright show with costumes for all, the world's biggest pumpkin, a trip to spooky world, and the scariest Halloween surprise of all. Tiny Tim gets married on the Tonight Show again. Will Matthew Broderick catch the garter? Plus this week, Julia Louis-Dreyfus, Lyle Lovett, Shannon Doherty, and more join all new fun on NBC.
I knew there would be mudslinging in this campaign. I knew my opponents would take the low route. When they don't have the answers for a high crime rate and failing economy, they try to pick a fight over something else. Desperate times make desperate incumbents, but they can't divert me from the issues. You know where I stand in this race. You know it's time for a change in government. Give me a chance to get the job done.
Rich Chocolate Ovaltine versus Nestle Quick.
This was Ovaltine? I never would have believed it. I haven't had it in forever. Oh, I'm really surprised. It's good, it's chocolatey, and I think Ovaltine's even better for you. The Rich Chocolate Ovaltine is really good.
Rich Chocolate Ovaltine is a different kind of Ovaltine, and its great taste will surprise you.
It sure tastes good. It tastes like normal, good stuff rather than something that's secretly healthy for you. So I think that the Ovaltine would be great.
Rich Chocolate Ovaltine.
The story of angels, our 11 News cover story tonight.
In the course of our lives, we come into contact with many people. For most, we never know if our lives have really touched theirs. But sometimes, with the help of angels, we're given the chance to share in the journey of another.
In April of this year, I was diagnosed with ovarian cancer, which had spread to, well, they named the places, and I thought they would never quit naming the places that were affected. And I've just learned in the last week that it's also in the liver now.
When you find a person with an ovarian tumor, which has metastasized, that is to say, tumor cells have spread inside the abdomen, and in her case, inside the chest also, it's a death sentence.
Virginia faced the frightening prospect of emergency surgery. Before entering the operating room, she had a surprise visit from her angels.
So I was a little nervous, needless to say. When they wheeled me into the operating room, they put me in a holding area, and I was shaking. I had my eyes closed, and I heard this noise. And I looked up, and there were two huge angels. I can't describe them exactly, but I knew that they were very, very powerful. And I thought, well, I could, knowing that I could die in a minute, I could think they had come to take me to heaven. But instead, it was a feeling of they were there to protect me. So I immediately quit shaking and relaxed and went into surgery, just very calm.
Virginia did not have to wait long before her next angel contact.
There were like maybe five or six feminine, not as big as the ones I had seen before, but they lifted me up. And I thought maybe this is like what it's going to be when you die, that you leave your old, sick, heavy body behind and you're so free and so weightless. We went to some of my relatives and to some of my friends, and they were all in bed asleep, and the angels would touch their cheek with their wings. I didn't know if we were saying goodbye to them or what, but it was such a wonderful, peaceful, happy feeling that there was nothing sad about it. If you ever wake up in the middle of the night and feel a breeze on your cheek, you've been touched by an angel.
Virginia underwent conventional medical therapy, but she was also guided by her angels to pursue alternative medical treatment. She was introduced to Myra Starr, a spiritual healer who had her own life-changing encounters with angels. Before 1989, Myra Starr was a corporate manager with no strong religious or spiritual convictions.
My dream was to have 365 outfits, so I only had to wear one at a time a year. And was known as the Terminator at one company because I went in and had a very harsh job of going in and firing people. Dealt with a lot of hard type people. It never fazed me. I could do it without blinking an eye.
But then on November 11th, 1989, something happened that would forever change the course of Myra's life.
I was up that morning giving myself my injections for allergies, and when I gave myself the shots, I realized I was in trouble immediately.
Myra struggled upstairs to reach her husband.
Within a matter of minutes, I was in convulsions. I remember just feeling a whole lot of pain and swelling and not able to breathe. And at one point, all I wanted to be able to do was to look at him and say, I love you one last time, because I knew that there was no more breath left in me.
As Myra collapsed into unconsciousness, her husband called for emergency assistance.
By the time the team got there to work on me, I was floating above the body. And I remember looking down and seeing all these men in there working on me. But I was just content watching. And then the next thing, I remember being in the vehicle, the ambulance. And I remember the man in the ambulance with me pulling the sheet up over my face. And it was as if part of me told him no, to uncover, not to let my husband see me be brought out with the sheet over my face. And I remember him pulling the sheet back down and had it laid just across at my neck. I also remembered going into the light. During the point of being in that light and in that secure feeling, I was told I would come back and teach. I remember that very vividly.
Myra did come back, but she quickly discovered that everything in her life had changed.
At first, I tried to resume my corporate job, and the nickname Terminator no longer stuck. I couldn't go in and do the kind of things that I was so known for. It took me a few months, and I finally resigned from where I was working. Took time and just stayed home.
It was during this time that Myra felt her first angel.
I asked her, I said, who are you really? And she laughed and she stood up and she looked at me and she said, but you know who I am. And I said, show me. And as I said, she gave the form of a young Indian woman. But as I looked at her, it was as if we would let a robe slide from our shoulders and it fell to the ground and she was the pure light. And she said, now you will remember. And you have the gift you were promised in the light.
The gift the angels brought was the power of healing. On July 25th, 1994, Myra and Virginia met for the first time, asking their angels to guide them.
When I first started working with her, I felt her body being very weak. And then as I worked around and I touched the bottom of her feet, there was a beautiful, tall, white angel appeared at the crown of her head. And as I envisioned looked, it took and spread its wings and they came all the way up and arched over its head as giving its approval and understanding and go ahead for her to continue on with what she has to do here, because she has a beautiful mission. And she will be able to finish that and allow the healing to take total place within her body.
I could feel strength entering my body that I haven't felt in a long, long time, since before my illness. So it's just a wonderful feeling. I feel like I could conquer the world at this point.
3 months after her healing session with Myra, Virginia received astounding news from her doctor.
My health has improved incredibly since that time. And I've had such good reports from the doctors. And so many of the tumors have disappeared. And I just am doing so much better than anyone ever expected me to do.
I think it's truly miraculous that she is still alive. And I've been dealing with patients like this for over 30 years now. I've never seen anyone do this well 6 months later.
I was so frightened, and I was so very, very sick. And my experience with the angels in the hospital helped me not to be afraid to die, but I still was afraid to live with the cancer. And I think my angels have helped me with this. I'm no longer afraid to live. I feel that it's a miracle, a very big miracle in my life, that regardless of what happens, whether I live or die, I'm no longer afraid.
Science often attempts to explain away miracles of healing, as luck or coincidence or nothing more than chance. To the faithful, though, chance is simply an angel's way of performing a miracle anonymously.
Angels 2, Beyond the Light, will continue in a moment.
They're poppable and handy, the perfect bite-sized candy. For good times, they're just dandy. New Nestle.
The Light will return in a moment.
They left Earth to find a new home and discovered we are not alone.
We were foolish to believe there was no intelligent life here.
It will take a mother's hope.
I know somehow we'll be all right here.
A father's strength.
It is about survival.
And all the courage they can find to make this planet home. Earth 2 premieres next Sunday on NBC.
Government employees have a right to be angry. This administration treats you like political pawns. It waits until 2 weeks before this election to pay you only half the rate you negotiated. They offer no retroactive pay. They admit this is political. They believe it's enough to buy your vote. This is no way to run a government. Take the pittance and vote them out. It's time for a change. It's time for a governor who respects the contractual rights of employees.
My left foot was killing me. It was just itching, itching, itching between the toes. Burning and itching.
Todd Adams of Haverhill, Massachusetts is telling us about Triple Action Gold Bond Medicated Powder.
I would apply Gold Bond Medicated Powder in between the toes, and it stops the pain instantly.
Gold Bond's Triple Action is the absorbing action of powder, the medicating action of a proven itch fighter, and the drying action of zinc oxide.
Gold Bond Powder. That's the difference between a good day and a bad day.
Try Triple Action Gold Bond Medicated Powder.
And I want you to know that we're going to go from water gut to free gut. We're going to go from Christiansted to Frankstead. We're going to go from Grove Place to Bordeaux. And we're going to go from Shaw Lamley to Cruz Bay. And when all is said and done, on November the 8th, 1994, we're going to win. And we're going to have a majority in the legislature. We're going to have a Democratic candidate in Congress. And we're going to have a governor and lieutenant governor who are Democrats in government house.
Derek Hodge and Alfred Heath, your team.
The battle over Bibles in Cherokee County schools tonight.
Where does inspiration come from? Is creativity in humans a spark of the creative force that made the universe? For thousands of years, angels have inspired artists as subjects of their work. But many people now feel that angels may be a source of creativity in all areas of life. Guardian angels may not only shelter us from harm, they may protect us from an impoverishment of the spirit. Through the ages, art has helped to shape the way in which people have thought of angels. Like mankind, the angels have gone through their share of changes. They've evolved and transformed from fearsome avengers to gentle messengers. The first angels were depicted in literature and art as fierce warriors. Archangel Michael, the weigher of souls and God's number one warrior, is said to have personally driven Satan and his dark angels out of heaven.
Originally, Christian artists did not portray angels with wings. The original angels in Christian art were wingless. Wings were added at a later date in the first few centuries of the Christian era by artists as symbols. The artists wanted to get across the idea that angels were spiritual beings that could move about very quickly. And then later artists added halos, the spiritual aura, the body of light that the angel consists of. The white robes that angels are often depicted as having are, I think, the artist's attempt to show the angel's body of light. A robe is natural to put on a figure. It's much easier to do that than to depict a shapeless glow.
But did angels directly influence the creation of these works? Could the muses of the great artists and poets have been angels themselves?
There are some cases in which people feel that the artist or the master literally possesses them in order to create a work of art. We know that Fra Angelico was one of the greatest of the Renaissance artists. I believe Fra Angelico used to pray for inspiration before he created his paintings.
But angels did not just influence painting.
It's not just art,
and a painting that angels have inspired. Poetry, great writing. I think a lot of the great novels are stories I think the angels have inspired. The most amazing one to me is poetry. You know, if you read William Blake, he, I guess, was considered quite insane during his time, and he wasn't popular till 100 years later. But he said that he was under the guidance of angels night and day.
Music is often said to be the language of the angels.
Our expression, the music of the spheres, comes from Pythagoras, the ancient Greek philosopher. And Pythagoras had the idea that there is a stream of divine music that runs through the universe. This kind of heavenly or divine music is one reason that angels are often depicted playing musical instruments or strumming their harps. I think it's fair to say that that there's a possibility that composers of great music are inspired by this heavenly stream.
Through the works of artists, we have received many inspirational images of the angelic kingdom. In a highly mechanized world, this art has helped us to remember to stay in touch with our spiritual side.
The Victorian era artist E.C. Burns-Jones told Oscar Wilde, "The more materialistic science becomes, the more angels I shall paint. Their wings are my protest in favor of the immortality of the soul."
For centuries, angels were depicted in art as celestial beings interacting with the famous biblical figures. But modern works now show angels as forming a more personal relationship with ordinary people, guiding us through our trials and tribulations. Artists like Arthur Douay, Nancy Bright, and Karen Martin Curry have been instrumental in creating this new way of thinking about and relating to angels.
There are many paintings of angels, but almost all of them have side views, if you look at them. There's a portrayal of Gabriel making the Annunciation to Mary. It's usually a side view. There's only a few and far between paintings of angels that will have a front view. This has to do with the change in consciousness of humanity, that we could only experience the angel side view. We couldn't take the full experience. And now humanity is beginning to be able to experience the full direct gaze.
Classical representations of angels often reflected biblical warnings about the dangers of sinning. Modern artists often focus more on creating angels that ask us to protect the environment and our fellow man.
The angels are very compassionate. The angels care a great deal about what's happening in this earth. I know there's a lot of suffering. I see it. Why do we have all these problems that are besetting us? My answer to that is that the angels are seeking to awaken us in a new way.
For Karen Martin Curry, the angels inspire her as she begins a new painting.
When I walk into my studio to paint, it's an experience that I usually don't tell many people. I begin doing the humblest of things. I scrape off the paint off my easel from the prior painting. I begin to go to the colors, and I let the colors speak because the colors are directly connected to the angels. We begin to do the work together. The images that I'm painting are experienced at the same time I'm doing it. I think that there are a lot of things that are happening on this planet this century. One of them is the development of a new art form. I think the heavens are asking us to create out of a new place. And I call this sacred creativity. We are the finest paintings of the divine. We are the sculptures of the heaven. Humanity and our development is the finest art project that has ever been.
There are people who do act as though their very lives are works of art directed by angelic inspiration.
Whatever your life's about, if you decide to bring the angels into it and live more creatively, you'll find a way. And the angels will help inspire you. You might all of a sudden want to do something you never thought you could do.
Sally Sharp expresses her creativity through writing and teaching about angels. But until her own encounter with an angel, these abilities were locked inside her because of serious learning disabilities.
I always struggled with my speaking and writing. I had wrote backwards, and then I had a very hard time pronouncing a lot of words. And so I was sent to speech therapists and handwriting specialists. But now that I'm pursuing a writing and speaking career, my greatest pains have turned into be my greatest joy.
It was just 3 years ago when an angel came to Sally and gave her the strength to overcome her challenges.
At that time, unexpectedly, I felt a presence and saw a white light to the right-hand side of me. And then I started receiving words, words by thought that came very fast, very clear. And I was led to get a notepad and a pencil. And at that time, I started just writing this message that I was receiving. And the message was the closest thing I've experienced of unconditional love. She said that her name was Celia and that she was my guardian angel and that she had been with me all my life. She told me I would be a writer and to start recording my experiences and information. And you have to understand, at this time, this was coming so fast. I was so deeply touched that I was crying with tears of joy and tears of pain at the same time.
Sally eventually left a highly successful career as a sales representative to follow a new path with a new sense of purpose.
In the beginning, I was led to just record my thoughts. And I didn't worry about how it was going to come together. I would go into this place of with soft music and a candle lit and ask for whatever needed to come through, and the words would just come. And they came very lovingly, gracefully, effortlessly. And it was like it was hard to even recognize my own work.
Later, Sally wrote and self-published 5 books, the last 2 about angels. And now she conducts seminars on how other people can enhance their creativity with angels.
And so when we go into this exercise, I want you all to try to just like turn a light switch on. You don't have to know what the question is, but your job, your exercise. My encounter with the angels have really changed the way I look at having my disabilities with speaking and writing. Now I can look at it from a different viewpoint and almost be grateful for the challenges and the difficulties, because now that I've overcome them, or overcame them, that it's instilled confidence in myself, and it's given me inner strength and a knowing that I can do whatever I want to do.
It's interesting to note that during man's most ambitious adventure, space exploration, 2 astronauts felt compelled to take with them the words of a man who lived his entire life in a small Midwest town. And though James Freeman never traveled into space himself, his words were quite literally heaven sent.
James Freeman is one of the most beloved poets of our time. His poems have been published throughout the world, but his inspiration comes from a lifelong relationship with angels and the celestial kingdom above. 2 astronauts, Buzz Aldrin and James Irwin, took his poems with them to the moon.
It is interesting. Only 12 men have walked on the moon. 2 of them carried something I wrote. I didn't know either of them. And I've met Irwin, of course. Never have met Aldrin. But I've always felt that somehow I was meant to be connected with those moon flights. I don't know exactly why.
One of Freeman's poems, I Am There, was left on the moon by James Irwin for future space travelers to discover. It was written under extraordinary circumstances nearly 50 years ago, when James Freeman learned that his beloved wife, Catherine, was ill with cancer.
Well, I wrote I Am There out of a very, very deep need, probably as deep a need as I ever had in my whole life. I was married, and I loved my wife. She loved me. And we'd been married for 13 years. And suddenly she told me she was ill, very ill. Would I get a doctor? And I did, and get a doctor to send her to. And I was scared. And when she went off to the doctor, I went to pray. And I started to pray when suddenly I heard a voice. Now, I'm always listening for an inner voice, but the voice was so real, so audible, so not mine and not coming out of me, that I actually turned around to see who was talking to me. And the voice simply said, "Do you need me? I am there." I was startled. And as I went on praying then, the voice began to say more to me. But I had an envelope in my pocket, and finally I thought, hey, I better write this down, because I wanted to give it to my wife. Catherine, really, was the most important thing that ever happened to me in my life. Finding that woman and somehow being lucky enough to have her love me, because she loved me. I've always thought maybe Catherine was an angel.
Catherine was rushed into emergency surgery, but the doctors were unable to remove the cancer.
And then he told me that the operation had been futile and that there was no hope for her whatever. And I went to her room and thought, I don't dare go in. But suddenly I heard her call, "Jim, Jim." And as I went into that room, I lay down by her and put my arms around her. And it was awful, that awful sense I had of, oh gosh, this unbelievably horrible thing has happened to us. But as we lay there, suddenly, I had a sense in the midst of all this agony that something had entered the room and was surrounding us. I felt its arms almost. Well, I've always said I felt as if it were like clouds or wings, and it held us. And I had, and she had the same sense. She told me too, she was feeling what I felt. And it was a sense again of a presence.
After Catherine died, James was moved to write about the experience.
We lay close, close to one another. And an angel came with its wings, put out the flame, and caught us up from hell, and wrapped us round with a wild tenderness I have not found again. We clung close as to love's own breast, love's heart, and in our torment were at rest. You cannot wake in hell without bestirring heaven, but let demons out, and you start flights of angels. This is so, although why it should be, I do not know. And I've always believed that, because it was such a strong sense that with all this agony around me and ugliness of death, suddenly I had that sense, that strong sense that you, suddenly in response to that came flights of angels. Do you need me? I am there. You cannot see me, yet I am the light you see by. You cannot hear me, yet I speak through your voice. You cannot feel me, yet I am the power at work in your hands. Though you fail to find me, I do not fail you. Though your faith in me is unsure, my faith in you never wavers, because I know you, because I love you. Beloved, I am there.
Is that good? Yeah, it means go. Enjoy that great chocolate taste.
Oh.
Ah.
We have debated the existence of angels for thousands of years. We keep thinking, if we build a bigger telescope, we may see them. If we conduct the right experiment, we may somehow prove their existence. It is a noble pursuit, this search for angels. But we may be looking in the wrong places. The indisputable evidence is in the lives of our families and friends who find the courage to face us and say yes. Their life has been changed, has been touched by this power we call angels. There need not be a rush of wings or a blinding flash of light. It is enough that where there was once pain, there is now hope. Where there had been suffering, healing has come. Where there was mistrust and anger, there is now love. These are the footprints of the angels. Thank you for watching.
To order a video cassette copy of tonight's special, call 1-800-304-ANGEL. The charge is $24.95 plus $4.95 shipping and handling.
You've been watching Angels 2, Beyond the Light. Next Sunday, the world premiere of Earth 2. The Earth's children are dying. Their only hope lies in one woman's quest to find a new home.
I'm a mother. I have a sick child.
No syndrome child has lived beyond 9 years. My son is 8, and I will not watch him die.
It's her reason for putting this whole trip together.
At first, their new world seems ideal.
It has all the characteristics of Earth.
Until the colonists discover they're not alone.
Oh, my God. On the ridge! My son.
Mom?
What have you done with him?
Next Sunday, Earth 2 premieres in a spectacular two-hour movie. Now, the network TV premiere of The Addams Family. NBC presents...
WXIA-TV, Atlanta's Emmy Award winner for Best Newscast. Atlanta's News Channel. This is 11 News Tonight.
Was this alleged White House gunman out to kill the president, or did he have a death wish? Good evening, I'm Kimberly Kennedy. Federal agents now have a note written by Francisco Martin Duran. It was left behind after he allegedly fired more than 30 bullets at the White House. The note details how Duran wanted his affairs handled if he died. Nina Jimenez reports as he sits in jail, federal agents look for more clues.
Federal agents used lasers to search for more bullets around the White House. The shooting spree left pockmarks scattered across the White House facade, five visible around the press area in the West Wing. Because of the shooting, a current investigation into White House security will be expanded.
I think in terms of the review that Secretary Benson has ordered, we're going to consider all measures necessary to ensure the safety of the president, the first family, and the White House complex without intruding too seriously where possible on the rights of citizens to enjoy the public access that for years we've celebrated in this country.
It was this access which enabled 26-year-old Francisco Martin Duran to get close with a Chinese semi-automatic assault rifle, ironically purchased the same day the president signed into law the crime bill banning them. Duran is not talking, but more details about the man from Security Colorado are emerging. He lived here with his wife and son before disappearing 1 month ago. Duran had been dishonorably discharged from the Army after spending 2.5 years for aggravated assault, disorderly conduct, and drunk driving. Among Duran's belongings, White House officials found a handwritten note detailing how he wanted his affairs handled if he died. The note is said to contain no threat against the president. Neighbors say Duran, who always dressed in Army camouflage, kept to himself.
Well, it's kind of scary, you know, but... he was hard to get to know. You know, he didn't talk to you at all very much.
Francisco Martin Duran was charged today with willfully damaging federal property and possessing a firearm as a convicted felon. It's still possible he could be charged with attempted assassination. Duran will be arraigned tomorrow. Kimberly, back to you.
All right, Nina, thank you. It has been 5 days now since a Union, South Carolina mother reported her two young sons missing in a carjacking, and still no sign of the children. Searchers on horseback combed the woods in the area around the reported abduction today, hoping to find some clues in the case, but their search turned up nothing. Sheriff Howard Wells says the intense media coverage of the missing boys has brought several tips, but nothing substantial.
We are still hopeful that they are alive and well, and that he will call us so we can come and pick them up. And until this time, we have not received that all-important call.
The sheriff says authorities are looking into one tip from an adjoining county, but still have nothing conclusive to give them direction in the case. Another twist in the debate over religion in our schools. This time, the setting is Cherokee County, where children have been sent home with Bibles in their book bags. Jerry Carnes reports it's a tradition some parents are trying to stop.
Her daughter is in fifth grade, so Margot Dower is always ready for the questions, the requests for help with homework. But last week, her 10-year-old came home with something she didn't expect, a Bible.
Mm-hmm. Your reaction was?
Where did you get this? And she said, at school. And I said, no, that you couldn't possibly have picked this up at school. I don't understand.
Apparently, it's become a sort of tradition at Boston Elementary and at least one other Cherokee County school. Boxes of Gideon Bibles are left outside the lunchroom for school kids to take, free of charge.
Okay. I mean, it doesn't seem to be okay. The Constitution doesn't allow for things like this. I mean, you know, obviously there's a clear separation of church and state.
The Dowers aren't the only people upset.
Concerned parents have complained to the local school board as well as the State Department of Education. What they've been told so far is if no one's handing the materials to students, as long as the books are just laid out there for anyone who wants them, everything is okay.
The key with the state seems to be as long as no one is forced to take the Bibles, it's legal.
It has now paved the way for every other religious zealot. If you don't want your kids reading the Satanic Bible, you know, they have every right now. They are considered a religion in this country, you know? I mean, it's frightening.
The debate over religion in schools has become a running feud in Georgia. First came the history teacher who refused to abide by the state-mandated moment of silence. Then the Cobb County High School that banished a Jesus is Lord banner from its stadium. It has many wondering once again exactly where the line between church and state is drawn. The Dowers say they'll do whatever it takes to get some answers. In Cherokee County, Jerry Carnes, 11 News tonight.
We called several members of the Cherokee County School Board for their response to Dower's complaints. Our messages went unanswered. Jury selection is set to begin tomorrow in the trial of an alleged cop killer. George Russel Henry is accused of murdering Cobb police officer Robert James Ingram in January of 1993 after a traffic stop. Officer Ingram was the first Cobb officer ever killed in the line of duty. If convicted, Henry could face the death penalty. The murder trial of a Clayton County doctor continues tomorrow. Dr. Eva Carrizales is accused of hastening the death of a premature baby. Her trial came to a sudden stop Friday when her husband complained of chest pains and had to be hospitalized. 67,000 people fill the Georgia Dome this afternoon for the final day of the Billy Graham Crusade. That adds up to a record for the Georgia Dome and a record for the Crusade itself. The Billy Graham Crusade came to Atlanta this week for the first time in 21 years. Over the five nights it was here, 311,000 people came to hear what will likely be Reverend Graham's last crusade here in Atlanta. Not only does that set a record for attendance at the Georgia Dome, the Atlanta Crusade has now become the most attended event in the history of the Billy Graham Crusade. Lotto fever is sure to grip the state again this week. That's because no one had all six numbers in last night's $13 million drawing. The jackpot now rolls over to an estimated $20 million, a new record high for Georgia's lotto game. Just ahead on 11 News, our exclusive Mason-Dixon poll. If the elections were held today, who would win in the 7th Congressional District race? Angels, do they really exist? We'll try to separate the fact, fantasy, and hype in our 11 News cover story. What sparked women to take off their bras and burn them in New York? And remembering the dearly departed on Halloween Eve is a sacred tradition for some folks. These stories and more ahead on 11 News. Seventh congressional district seat is one the national Republican Party is hoped to grab in 2 weeks. But an exclusive 11 News Mason-Dixon poll shows if the election were held today, Democrat Buddy Darden would be reelected. Our Don Hatcher has more on this poll from our Rome Bureau deep inside the 7th district.
For the first time since taking office in 1983 after Congressman Larry McDonald was killed, Buddy Darden, a Democrat, is facing his most serious challenge for reelection. Former U.S. Attorney Bob Barr, a Ronald Reagan appointee and a Republican, has gotten closer to Darden in the polls than anyone ever has. According to our exclusive 11 Alive Mason-Dixon poll, if the election were held today, Buddy Darden would win with more than half the vote. And there are still a lot of undecided voters in the North and West Georgia district. On another question, if you recognize the candidate, how do you feel about him? 42% rated Darden favorably, while 47% of those who know the name Barr remain neutral.
Bob Barr, running for Congress.
Barr has tried to make the central issue here Darden's close support of President Clinton's programs, which have been unpopular in the more conservative areas of the district.
When Buddy Darden supports Bill Clinton 92% of the time, and when the vast majority of people in the 7th District don't like the higher taxes and the bigger government that Clinton has given them, then it does become a very, very important issue in the race.
Hi, Buddy Darden.
But Darden is running on his record, with little mention of his fondness for the president.
The issue is look at the people and who can you depend upon and who you trust. Who's carried the ball? Who's done the job? Who's one of the people who represents them here?
Our 11 Alive Mason-Dixon poll indicates the candidate's performance is the biggest issue this year, followed by crime and drugs, taxes and government spending, health care, and then education. Well, our exclusive survey was made last weekend with 425 likely voters deep inside the 7th District. Of those questioned by phone, 47% of them said that Darden is most likely to continue the policy of getting good contracts for the Lockheed Georgia company, while only 19% of them thought Barr could do that. The survey asked voters to rate the congressman's performance in office for the last 2 years. 56% of them say that Darden has done a good or excellent job. And all of this means altogether that Darden is a favorite for winning the election in about a week and a half from now. But the distance between him and Barr should get much closer. After all, it is a horse race.
A lot can happen in 9 days.
Absolutely.
Thank you, Don. Sex education and welfare reform dominate tonight's debate between the three candidates for lieutenant governor. Republican candidate Nancy Schaefer blamed an increase in teen pregnancies on sex education in the classroom. Libertarian Walker Chandler blamed the state's social ills on big government and public education. But incumbent Pierre Howard says nonpartisan politics is the best way to make government work for the people. An innocent-looking can of baby formula turns out to be a bomb. It exploded and killed 4 people in Iraq as U.S. soldiers maintain their presence near that country's border. That story makes world news tonight. The bomb exploded outside a church, killing 3 police officers and a deacon. Police were trying to defuse the bomb when it exploded. 3 other people were injured. So far, no one has claimed responsibility. In San Antonio, Texas, hundreds attended the funeral of Navy combat pilot Kara Hultgreen. She died when her plane crashed off the California coast on Tuesday. Navy officials still don't know what caused the crash. Hultgreen was one of the first Navy women trained to fly in combat. And in New York, some women are taking off their bras, not to make a fashion statement, but to burn them. That's right, an old-fashioned bra burning. Earlier this week, a New York City clerk was threatened with losing her job when she came to work braless. Coming up next on 11 News, a heavenly question. Do angels really exist? Some folks say yes. We'll introduce you to some true believers in our 11 News cover story. Bonnie?
And it looks as though we may have a few storms in the forecast for tomorrow, but chilly temperatures will mark midweek. I'll have a look at that forecast in a moment.
New cars are always in the news. And this year, some really incredible things have been happening. The news is out on Toyota, and the 1995 Corolla is here. Right now, you can lease Corolla for just $169 a month. Or with incentives and option savings, you could save up to $1,200 when you buy a new Corolla. This year is looking very good for Toyota and very good for you.
You may not be able to see them or hear them, but in tonight's cover story, meet some Georgians who believe they've been touched by angels. Everyday people who say they've had an extraordinary encounter that has made them believers in the unbelievable. Beth Galvin explains.
There's a huge hunger out there that people have to know more about this and to experience it.
They are powers that have always been there. They've always been around us.
Angels. To some, they are messengers from God. To others, figments of the imagination. Atelle Deloach believes she's been walking with angels since childhood, and all of us have our own guardian. She believes it is angels who send the sick to her, and angels who move through her hands to heal.
As I pass my hand over the person, my hands tell me where the problem is. The doctor doesn't have to tell me. No one has to tell me. I will know. I will know.
And Etel says she knows, too. She is not alone.
Everyone has a guardian angel. Their guardian angel wants to work with them, wants to be a true, helpful, you know, companion to them 24 hours a day. All they have to do is allow it to happen.
Angels may remain a mystery to many of us, but according to a Time CNN poll, many Americans believe in them. 69% of the people asked say they think angels exist. A third of those people say they think they've had an encounter with one.
Those numbers don't surprise Rex Houck, the Atlanta-based filmmaker who's now produced two angel documentaries for NBC.
I think everyone has had an encounter with the force that we call angels, and we dismiss it as coincidence, timing, luck, chance, whatever.
Houck believes those willing to admit they've had an angel experience have a tough time sharing their stories.
I think as more people talk about their spiritual experiences, it gives their friends or their family permission to start saying, hey, I felt that too. I had something like that happen to me once.
Experiences Linda Vepula is trying to capture in her brand new magazine, Angel Times, a $50,000 investment the Atlanta publisher is hoping will fly with angel lovers.
We're not scared. We don't have any fear. We don't see it as a trendy thing. We see it as real.
A real market for angel merchandise. There's not just Angel Times, there are angel stories, angel books, even a CD-ROM on angels. So whether all of this is just a fad or it's going to be around for the long run, only time's going to tell.
A regular cottage industry.
Exactly.
I think I have one. I do.
You do?
I think I do.
What?
An angel.
Oh, I thought you
got it. Cottage industry.
Never mind.
Thank you, Beth. Well, speaking of spirits, Halloween in Atlanta is being celebrated in more ways than one this weekend. The Day of the Dead.